I'm Timothy Leary, and I'm 75 years old, and as a matter of fact, I believe that I just now have died. It was a wonderful experience. Awesome. It's exciting. It's the most important decision you make in your life.
The message is very simple. It can be said in six words. Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
All right, Timmy. Yeah.
Timothy Leary lives. No, he's outside looking.
Well, I'm Timothy Leary, and I'm 75 years old, and I've been very active for the last 60 years.
That morning, you know, right after he died, and the press was here and all that, we were woken up to the sounds of the helicopter who came, like, right here, really low, you know, filming the house, and it just was such a surreal experience. Looking back on it, I don't even really remember what happened that day. Timothy Leary. With all these reporters outside, and it was on CNN, and I was like, God, this is real. You can't argue with that.
What time did it pass?
12:45 a.m.
We're doing a documentary on Timothy Leary. Have you ever heard of Timothy Leary?
Yes, I have.
What have you heard about Leary?
Well, he's old, and he's about to die on the internet.
Timothy Leary lives.
Leary spoke of what he called designer death, and of turning his passing into a celebration.
When that moment comes, I'm here. I may decide, hey, no, I just top me in the grass and let the worms eat me.
I had my finger on his neck, on his pulse, right, as right. He was fading out of his body. And it was the most remarkable experience. He had a sense of humor all the way through to the end.
Each person dies in their very individual, singular way.
He showed us that it's possible to die and to go on to a new reality.
The main decision of your life is how, when, why, and with whom you die.
He really looked at it as the final adventure, as his last trip.
I could feel the body leaving, the soul leaving the body, and I never have felt such a moving experience, because I knew intellectually that this was one of the greatest minds in the world.
But that is, you know, that's typical of the way he characterizes his life.
We're making a movie. Our search for the real Timothy Leary is part of it.
I rather doubt we'll start shooting. I mean, you know, it's going to take time. Once we get in there, there's a lot of logistical, I mean, just negotiating his bedroom is hard. One of his friends told me yesterday that he was really happy to have as many people come visit him as possible, because he feels that, you know, everybody knows by now that his death is an open book. And it's a designer death, if you like, although the expression sounds kind of grim. I just felt when I met him that he was a man of total dedication to the inner search, as well as being a trickster.
48 hours just doing it.
And a comedian.
And Entertainment Tonight.
And he's done stand-up comedy in the last 10 years.
People magazine is doing it.
People tend to forget these little things about him.
I have to tell you that I honestly felt maybe this whole death thing was being staged just to get more publicity.
So he's ready now. We can go there.
Yeah, he's waiting right now.
Well, he always liked California, and he felt that the movie industry was the Bible of the 20th century. You know, Danny, it's funny. You would have thought he would have lived in Berkeley, or maybe the Lower East Side, or somewhere, you know, or Northern California at least. But no, that says something about his love of media attention. I mean, he wanted people to think and feel and perceive differently. He felt that Hollywood was the place to do it.
How about calling it Dead Man Talking?
Yeah, the house was a crazy circus, you know, all the time. 90% of it I really enjoyed, you know, thoroughly, even growing up. You know, there was always the 10% where I'd just want to go run and hide, and there were all these people in the house.
And I said to him once, you meet a lot of people, man. You have too many people in your house and too many people in your life. And he said, oh, I meet hundreds of people a week once. But very few ever come back.
I do visit him, but of course, I try to avoid the crowd, you know.
I remember John Belushi wrestling with Tim in the living room 3 nights before he died. John Belushi died.
He was a guy who you met, and in 5 minutes you felt you were one of his dear friends.
I remember, you know, Ringo Starr coming over and going, wow, that's a Beatle.
He seems to like that. He seems to, it seems like it was, it's okay with him, but the fact that all these people are coming around.
A lot of people just know where he lives and just sort of show up. Everyone here that works with Tim, we're all trying to find internal freedom.
Well, a club promoter and a booker.
Here we were kind of chosen to work up here.
Let me know if you guys want to tour some of the art.
We're all a piece of Tim's life now.
It's like an internship.
It's a chance of a lifetime.
He always believed in the generational gap, that, you know, the success of our future lies within the young people. You know, since, you know, 1960, 63, you know, he was always surrounding himself with people who were younger than he was.
Maybe he's saying that, I'm dying, you know, and everybody's saying, oh, okay, well, let's put this on video or something like that, but maybe he's going to live another 10 years, who knows?
I'm Timothy Leary, as a matter of fact, I'm not dead.
Timothy Leary. Well, I'm Timothy Leary, and I'm 75 years old, and I've been very active for the last 50 or 60 years. And it's always interested me, the taboos. See, in the 20s and 30s, sex was the taboos being, you know, you had the roaring 20s, and the middle-class ladies were dancing, showing their knees and all of that. That was quite new. And then, of course, drugs were the taboo in the 60s and 70s. Dying is now taboo. No one wants to think about it. It's exciting. It's the most important decision you make in your life. It's the how and when and how, with whom and why. There are some other W's here, too. You die. You have to arrange your dying, design for dying, dignified dying, dying with dignity. That's a hot topic that was not talked about even 5 years ago.
He was not afraid to speak about authority, to be open to possibility, to encourage people, empower individuals to cultivate their own minds and their own lives. And I think his ability to dance from psychedelics through space travel, through virtual reality, through dying, was extraordinary.
Last January, a year, 13 months ago, I was told I had prostate cancer, which is running around loose. So I'm terminally ill with cancer.
He said, you know, I've been diagnosed with prostate cancer, and I don't want to do anything about it, which was, you know, the clincher.
He was diagnosed as having inoperable cancer. 6 months after we met, we were new friends at the time, and ironically, I was one of the very first people he told that he had this diagnosis. He had had it diagnosed the day before I arrived in LA for a business trip, and he and I had lunch that day. So it was only 24 hours old, this news to him.
You know, lots of people get diagnosed with prostate cancer. 60% of all men over the age of 65 in the United States, and most of them choose to do something about it. But when he made it clear that he didn't want to do anything about it, you know, what can you say to that? You know, what that basically means is that he's making the choice to die, you know, that he's content with his life thus far and he's ready for the next journey.